if you'll just turn right around. We have a camera right here behind you. On the count, we're going to do two photos here, guys. On count three, go nuts. One, two, three. Perfect. There we go. We got table and chairs for you.
I hope this dance thing is working. Yes, good. That's a wonderfully warm welcome, and I thank you for it. It is a joy to come back to Salt Lake City. I came here a few years ago, and I did one of your Christmas shows, which was quite an experience. And if there are any members of the choir here, can I just say what a joy it was, and what an experience it was for them. Oh, look, I've got a chair. Magic, just like that. So what should we talk about today? Do you know, I was looking at all those characters and thinking, God, haven't I been lucky doing all that? And you notice some of the people that I was working with? Gosh, aren't they a talented bunch? Anyway, okay, well, let's get started. Who's got some silly questions? I should first of all say, no, I don't have Orlando Bloom's personal phone number. And just for the record, no, I never did hang out with him, and certainly not in quite that manner. Anyway, private joke, never mind. Right, fire away.
Hi, is this on? Everybody hear me? I just thank you for coming back. It's great having you here. I read that you're a member of the Planetary Society, and I've heard you mention before that we need more people in the sciences, and so I wanted to ask you, for those of us who do work in science, what can we do to get more people interested, in particular young kids?
The question is, basically, do we need more people in science, and how do we do it? Of course we need more people in science, but more than that, we actually need to culture a scientific mind. And though we live in a world where there is an awful lot of science at the moment, there is an awful lot of bogus science too. I do not say this merely as an irrational artist. I would point out that the editor of the Lancet, the ex-main editor of Lancet, 2 years ago said that he thought that 50% of articles that were published in medical magazines were either fraudulent or you could not reproduce the results. This is scandalous. Real science is very hard. It is very, very hard to get to sigma phi, but even sigma one in some of these cases will be rather good. What can we do? Well, we start off by being good parents.
Woo!
Yeah.
Yes! Woo!
And this community is remarkably good and effective in being good parents. I say this quite objectively because I travel the world and I see the problems of men and women, young men and women too, and in many ways most societies need a way they need some ritual that brings young men and young women into adulthood. The Maasai warriors used to kill a lion. When you were old enough to claim to be a man, you went out with the hunters, and they found the lion, and they would let the lion charge at you and your two or three claimants to be a warrior. You killed your lion, you were a man. And the mission actually serves a similar sort our process. I often meet your young missionaries in New Zealand and places like that. These are young men away from home for the first time. Young women, too, I have to say. Well done. Well done. And night after night, they go back in tears. They know they are failures. They know they are not living up to the dreams that they had hoped to lead to. They're not meeting any targets at all, personal or presented. They feel themselves lonely, homesick, and failures. And the next day they've got to get up and try again. And the next day, and the next day. And in the end, they have experienced so much that nothing in life ever again will become so great a challenge to them. And that is one of the reasons why. That's one of the reasons why your community is so successful. And it's a remarkable achievement. But I'm still not answering your question, am I? It begins with good parenthood, then good teaching. And that sense that science shouldn't just be something that only the very, very cleverest people can get into. I mean, the celebrated case was Einstein, wasn't it, who failed to get into the equivalent of graduate school but because his maths wasn't good enough. Mine should be that good. So I think we need to demystify science, and we need to regard the scientific study of the world, our society, the way we live, as being important and natural to all of us. I have actually met some rocket scientists, and they're pretty smart people, but they're also very decent and human people. More interestingly, I'm sorry, I'm really avoiding your question. Look, I look at the world and I see four challenges coming in one area. One, there's a very good economist called Robert Gordon who says that we may have to revisit the idea that we will naturally do better than our mothers and fathers did. That the period between 1870 and 1970 is a period of extraordinary growth in personal income per capita. He points out that between the end of the Roman period, Rome in 410, and 1300, income per head in Europe didn't rise. Between 1300 and 1700, it doubles. But it's this extraordinary transformative period, particularly in the American economy between 1870 and 1970, that suddenly every generation is making more money, has more jobs, has more opportunities, living better houses, has better health standards than ever before, and each generation is doing better. Now what he's saying is there is going to be a sort of, if you think the norm is sort of like that, suddenly it went way up to the top, and now we are regressing down to the norm again. That's one rather disturbing thing. The second is, it's said by 2034, 50% of our jobs will be replaced by machines. The third thing, of course, is it is that the ownership of those machines looks like being very uneven. It isn't that we will have the luxury that and the leisure time that the ownership of this machinery will have. Right at the moment, it looks as if something like 7 people have a net worth the equivalent of the lowest 3.4 billion people on the planet. The third thing is that the growth in income, or the growth in population rather, we're at about 7 billion now. By the end of the century, we get to about 11 billion, 10, and the bulk of that is going to come from Africa. Why is this concerning? Because Africa does not have an ability yet, it would seem, to organize society in any sort of equitable way. The population of the world is sort of slowing down. The population of Europe is positively imploding. In order to have a stable population, you need 2.1 babies per person. If you have more men, population rises, per woman rather. Population, if you have less than that, eventually the population will fall. Now in Italy, they're down to something like 1.1 live birth per woman. I've seen a figure, and I cannot tell you how accurate it is, but I have seen it, that suggests that the population of Italy, which is now about 47 million, drops to about 8 million Italians by the end of the century. This is a catastrophic implosion. The population of Africa, however, goes from 1.1 billion to 4.3 billion. The truth is that a country that I knew, Ethiopia, when I was a boy, in 1950, Ethiopia had a population of 18 million people. Throughout those periods when we saw famine, population of the average Ethiopian woman was having 7 babies. It's now down to 4.5 babies. By 2050, it's going to be down to 3.5, and the United Nations thinks that by the end of the century, it'll be down to 2.5, by which time the population of Ethiopia will be 243 million people. I know the country, I know the resources, I know the marvelous people, but I'm here to tell you there is no way that a decent standard of living can be had in Ethiopia with a population that size. They will have to migrate, and the scale of the migration is going to cause enormous social and cultural and probably racial conflict. Of course, you're not meant to say things like that because we all live in Hollywood and it's all peace and love and all that sort of thing. But the real truth is there are problems that no one's prepared to look at. And perhaps it is with a scientific mind that we can look at things, make worst case estimates, make best case estimates, and do what we can to try and find ways around it. We have grown up believing that growth is a good thing and is inevitable. But what if it isn't? What's our best case solution? One suggestion that I would make, for instance, would be that we manage decline in numbers. In other words, we don't say, oh my God, we've got to have more people, because otherwise our standard of living will decline. If, as Gordon says, and if, as the proponents of artificial intelligence say, we're going to be facing real competition for jobs, And perhaps what we should be thinking of doing is, instead of adding more people looking for fewer jobs, let's try and manage the numbers of jobs that we have and match them to a declining population. We're all living longer. You know, my daughter, who's 10 now, has a reasonable chance of living a fairly active life, probably into her hundreds. Her first century, anyway. Reasonable chance of that. And so perhaps one of the... I'm so far off the question. The answer is, I don't know. But I'm awfully glad that we do have science and scientific minds. And I urge you all, join the Planetary Society and just think of that big universe out there, because that's probably where we should end up fairly soon. Take it. Sorry. Next question.
John, you seem like a great person. I'd love to hear you speak. I actually did serve one of those missions to Guatemala. I chose that over killing a lion, mostly because I'm a dentist, and dentists killing lions are a no-no these days. That being said, having my hands in people's mouths all the time, I'm always worried that someone's going to bite them, because it's happened before. But one benefit of if they ever did get bitten off, I would be your twin. So, right there.
Is that the point you were making? Okay.
And I just wanted to ask, how did that happen? You weren't a dentist at one point, were you?
Well, I was actually exploring one of the upper rivers of the Lualaba Valley, and I was with Tufty at the time, and Tufty was having a bit of a tough time. You know, he'd lost one leg, poor fellow. We had been trekking across Africa about 6,000 or 7,000 miles, but he was such a game fellow. And he went into the Dam River ahead of me, and this crocodile, this enormous crocodile, pounced on poor old Tufty. Well, naturally, of course, a chap just can't let a fellow Englishman sort of die like that. So I plunged in, fought with the crocodile for several hours. And I didn't get Tufty's leg back. But he was a game fellow. He said, look, John, you go on, old boy. I mean, I'll catch up a bit later. I said, well, you're going to have a little bit of a problem with that, aren't you? You haven't got any legs left. And he said, oh, don't worry about me, old boy. You know, I'll make it. Game fellow. So anyway, this was a casualty of the fight with the crocodile. I had to just shape it up a little bit just to get it through. Then I threw Tufty on my back, and what was the next 7,000 miles? And as a dentist, you'll be listening to my diction. And you probably know that I've just had some work on the upper gums, and I have a false plating that is moving like heck. So, like it suddenly springs out of my mouth. You will know it's just this temporary damn plate that the dentists have fitted, and we hate dentists. No! All right, carry on, next time. Well done. Yes.
In the second Hobbit movie, the elves sees the hobbits and the dwarves, and Legolas is looking through, I think it's glowing stuff, and he sees a picture of like his wife and his son, and he's like, oh, who is this horrid creature? And Glowing says, what? That's my son Gimli. Was that a picture of you? Anybody you knew?
The elves can be very cavalier in their assessment of their dwarvish beauty. The real thing is, as many of will you, many men will have explained to you, Gallants, that the truth is a kiss without a mustache is like beef without mustard. But dwarvish beauty, with those long beards, thick luscious hair, and like those scabby looking creatures that you saw in The Hobbit. Dear me, half the makeup, I mean half the good looks that they're... yes, yes, what was the question again? I see the problem. But the truth of the matter is that, you know, young Legolas needed to meet the world and meet the true glory of dwarfdom before he actually understood life.
Since you did play both Gimli and Treebeard in Lord of the Rings, in your personal life right now, would you rather have the bravery of Gimli or the wisdom of Treebeard?
How can I confess to lacking both? I suppose that as you get older, you should know a little bit more. And one of the first things you should know, you should not give a 20-minute talk about population and jobs to even the most intelligent audience. And you are a smart audience, actually. You're a very smart audience. Lord of the Rings audiences are very smart anyway, because most of them have either read the book before they see the film, or they see the film and then go back and read the book. And it's a darn big, heavy book. If you can get through that, you are by definition smart. But this is a very smart community anyway. You are so well disciplined, you are so well mannered, and courteous, it would not surprise me if you were recognizably higher on the scale of intelligence than most communities around the world. So I may neither have the wisdom of Treebeard or the bravery of Gimli. But I hope I've discovered a little bit of diplomacy, perhaps, in the last few minutes. Carry on, please.
My question for you is, I'm just curious, what was your reaction when a tall person such as yourself was being casted in Lord of the Rings as a dwarf?
Horror. Why would you want to be in a prosthetic makeup to begin with? Why would you want, having spent 30 years of your career trying to become recognizable, wish to become completely unrecognizable? Why would you want to go to New Zealand with a film director who'd done three or four little pictures and who suddenly thought he could produce this unplayable, unproducible, non-dramatic, extraordinary fantasy book called Lord of the Rings? The probability of it coming out of New Zealand was negligible. There was no tradition of filmmaking in New Zealand other than Peter Jackson's rather small movies. You know, anyone can actually make a movie. You take four actors or six actors and write a simple story. Any one of you can make a movie. But when you've got 21 principal characters, when you've got at least 14 months of principal photography, when you have, on some days, 1,200, 1,400, 1,600 extras with horses, and wranglers, and trailers for the horses, and drivers for the trailers. You know, how do you feed them? What happens when we go down to Christchurch and it's raining a bit? And here is the production office, and here is the center of Christchurch. There are 3 miles of road between the two. And then it starts raining. When I say starts raining, it doesn't stop. The rain actually washes out 11 houses up there and the road right between there and there. Now we have a 19-mile track, single way, connecting the production office and the actors. As it happens, the actors have got their own little problems. Well, how can I put it this way? It's the only time I've had the hat to climb up a step ladder in order to get into my hotel room. Because the entire bottom floor of the hotel was flooded. And then, of course, the call sheet went out. There will be no filming tomorrow as the lake is underwater. Now, this is a moment that separates real filmmakers from the also-ran. Because once you get behind on a project of this scale, you never get out of it. You start losing a day or two here, a week or two there, you lose a month, and spirits fall, and the money begins to dry up, and it all comes to a sad end. That call sheet that came out said, there will be no filming tomorrow because the lake is underwater. The following day, all of us went off to a different part of New Zealand. And you have to understand, this is not the New Zealand that you go to now that's full of motels and hotels and newly built tourist areas. You know, this is remote New Zealand that's never had really much tourism at all. And within one day, the 200 or 300 members of the crew and cast and actors are rebilleted. And the following day, we start work again. And we go back to Christchurch about 6 months later. When you're making a major film, it is a logistical exercise, as complicated as that as moving a small army. And that's the real genius of Peter Jackson. He was not only a great filmmaker, but he put the team together that actually could solve the problems. Everyone should work in the film industry at least some of the time. Why? Because we are not interested in your reasons why you cannot do something. We're not interested. Now, there's a problem, what's the solution? And as my friend Stephen said at dinner last night, Stephen, if you're here, not only one solution, but we want 2 or 3 solutions. And that's the job. If the director says to you, "You, I'm shooting this way after lunch, and you see that funny little mound in the background over there about 100 yards away, I want 2 zebra there." There is no point in saying to him, "Sir, we are in the middle of the Caribbean and there is not a zebra to be had for 3,000 miles. You say, "Right, sir." And at lunchtime you go out, and if you can, you hire, and if you have to, buy two small donkeys and paint them. So that after lunch, you can go up to the director and say, "Well, sir, sir, I've got the zebra for you in the background." And he'll go, "Zebra? Oh, yes. That was a stupid idea anyway. I'm shooting that way, and I..." And that's filmmaking.
I think something we can all agree on is that the banter between Gimli and Legolas during the entire trilogy is one of the funniest things that any of us have ever seen. My question is, behind the scenes and during the filming, what was there more to the banter? Did you guys go off script? Did you guys do pranks on each other?
This is almost a variant of the one that I always used to get from shy girls immediately the film came out. Did you and Orly hang out a lot together? The truth was, he was 19, I was 55. If we had been hanging out together, worry. They were a marvelous cast. They were so full of energy and life, and there was only one miserable son of a bitch on that show. And unfortunately, I wore his boots every day. You have to understand that the makeup was fine. There was nothing wrong with the makeup, it was the person underneath it. We were using medical adhesive, and medical adhesive is hypoallergenic. You don't react to it, but you're not meant to take it off on a daily basis because it really bonds to the cells of the skin. The more you take it off, the more the cells of the skin that you take off. So I lost all the skin around my eyes like that. And it was just red, wet lymph. And of course, when you do that, you get inflammation setting into the face, it swells. I looked hideous. It was not the happiest of experiences, let me tell you. I didn't want to go out. When I looked at myself in the mirror, you know, I thought, oh God, he looks awful. Even more so than normal, you know. But it was a really bad experience. And added to which, I was the tallest member in those days of the fellowship. So it was very hard when we were doing reverse shots, and I would have to get down like this, and they'd say, "Lower, lower." You know, you can't actually get much lower. But to give people a proper eye line, so then they started using one of my three doubles, who were, you know, midgets and pretty small anyway. Added to which, makeup for me was generally an 8-hour experience during the course of the day. A basic 5-hour put on, and then sit around, and if anything creased or crinkled, then it was another hour in the fixing. So, rapidly, it became a business of doing some of the scenes that we could do and had to do together. But often, you know, I would wait for them to go home at the end of the day, and then I would do my bit. And Peter would say, okay, that's what we've got that now, so, all right, John, I'm gonna cut you loose now. And I would start improvising and banting, and, you know, if I heard him giggle, I knew it would make at least the first cut of the film. They were marvelous. They were such delightful young men, and they had a lot of fun together. And it was not their fault that I wasn't part of that fun. It was fine at the beginning, but you end up having to separate yourself because you can't be there fooling around too much, because it means that the makeup gets messed up. And it is a huge prosthetic thing. You'll notice that the dwarves in The Hobbit had virtually no makeup on at all. They just had a tiny little bit. And that was one of the lessons they learned from Gimli. Keep the minimum makeup on, because it just takes too much time. I mean, even so, Peter Jackson did say on the premiere, he said that he knew perfectly well why Walt Disney had chosen to have no more than 7 dwarfs. Because 13 were just a handful. Yes. Anyway, sorry, next question.
Thanks, Sorry, so you actually could have touched on this a lot, but anyone who's seen the movies, and especially those who have read the Lord of the Rings books, know that Gimli and Legolas form a really close friendship by the end of that story. And so I was wondering if there's anyone in the cast that you thought you formed a really strong friendship with as a result of making that movie.
Actors generally form real bonds with each other. I was particularly impressed by Viggo. Who is an extraordinary man. Viggo is one of those unusual creatures who could actually earn his keep as a commercial or art photographer. He is a very, very good painter. You remember that film he did with Michael Douglas? It was a three-hander, Michael Douglas, and he was basically the woman's lover, and Douglas finds out and employs him to try and murder his wife. There's a scene in it where Viggo is playing an artist. There's a shot in his studio. All the pictures in that studio were painted by Viggo. He is a really considerable graphic artist. I mean, a painter, a portraitist. He's also not a bad poet. He's also got a very eclectic sort of mind. And I always found that talking to Viggo, he was really bright and really sharp. And of course, the studio would hate somebody like Viggo, because what you want is an actor who will consistently be a star, who will only pick starring vehicles and who will make you megabucks. But you see, somebody like Viggo is not really primarily interested in the money. He's interested in the journey. He's interested in the experience. You show him a script that he likes, with no funding, with very limited audience interest. That's what he wants to do. He doesn't want to, sit around for 2 years waiting for Superman or something equally absurd like that. Did I say that? I didn't mean that. Some of the young hobbits are such bright fellows. Young Pippin, for instance, is a very skilled bookbinder. I bet you didn't know that. He is pretty much a master craftsman for rebinding old books in leather and tooling them and things like that. I've always sort of been rather more interested in actors who had a world outside acting than, than actors whose whole world was acting. But each of them had a Sean Astin, the future president of the United States.
Yeah!
I mean, they were all individuals and wonderful and worked well together. And it was a real joy to know them. I just wish I had spent more time with them. It just wasn't possible, really. Sorry, that's a long answer, big problem.
Hello, first off, followed you for a long time, and on behalf of everyone here, thank you for coming.
Woo!
And second off, we've heard a lot of actors in that talk about different things that they ended up taking with them on accident from the set. Is there anything that followed you?
Oh.
No pressure.
I did get given my axe.
Oh!
One of them, anyway. And I do have a Hall of Shame in which the trophies of 50 years of misspent acting are displayed. But yeah, you know, it's... an actor is a work in progress. You know, I just... The real thing that I take from Lord of the Rings was the chance of meeting so many marvelous fans and just some good memories from some good people that you take into the next show that you do. It may not be as big as Lord of the Rings, it may be small. The great thing about being an actor is the community of filmmakers and filmmaking. You learn far more, you know, from your fellow actors and from the guys working on the set than you can ever imagine. And that's the real trophy that you take away. Something, sometimes it's tangible, like a hat from Raiders of the Lost Ark or something like that. But the real memories are, the real thing you take away are your memories and the jokes and the laughter and the idiosyncrasies. That's the real memorabilia you take.
Thank you. Hi, I actually wanted to ask you about your work in Winter Thought and what you learned most from it. It's such a heart-touching film. I just wanted to know like what you took away most from it.
The film that you're referring to is called Winter Thaw, and it was for Brigham Young University Television. A wonderful experience. We shot it in 10 days in, good God, which of those countries were it now? Lithuania. The Lithuanians are extraordinary people. Actually, they're a little bit under threat at the moment because Putin's Russia is making feelers to recovering some of the territory that the Soviet Union lost when it ceased to be the Soviet Union. So Estonia, Lithuania, Latvia are all really feeling that the bear is about to pounce on them again. So it's important anyway to make films there and to, in a way, assert our solidarity with them, I suppose. But I must avoid politics. Oh, God, avoid politics. what a wonderful people. And it was an extraordinary experience. It was an hour-long show, and I think we did it in 10 days or 11 days. Maybe it was 12 days, but it was very, very short time. And it was a wonderful experience. Now I better not talk about my 6 months recent experience, which was a complete waste of time. I mustn't talk about that, no. I mustn't do that. But anyway, sometimes it is a contrast to do a short, beautifully written, beautifully planned, beautifully directed, beautifully edited piece like that that just comes from Tolstoy, comes from the heart of the great Russian soul in, you know, in 1885 or something like this. It's a glorious piece, and I was so lucky to be involved. Loved it. I urge you all to look at it because it's about redemption in a way. It's an old man who's lost faith in everything and finally gets it back and comes to life again. Will that do? You want me to tell you a story from Sliders?
Yes.
You mean one that can't be quoted in court and used against me? Yeah. Sliders is something that I'm still annoyed about. I'm partly annoyed because I didn't handle it well enough. But largely because it was such a waste of an opportunity. That show could still be on the air. That show could actually have been the equal of Star Trek. And that's saying something, because I love Star Trek. I'm a real Trekkie myself. It's just that we did not seem to have writers who understood anything about science, let alone science. Well, they hadn't written any science fiction anyway. Every show became their redaction of Night of the Living Dead, The Island of Dr. Moreau. They can use the same masks for that one. Twister, Tremors, you name it, we did our own TV version of it. For me, it was that moment I walked into the writer's building and saw them standing around the watching the screen because Species had just been released on DVD. You know, and they were saying, well, we could take that scene and we could give them that one there, and then we could go to this scene there. You know, I worked with real writers, and it just seemed to me that sort of cheap plagiarism was cheating the audience. It could have been the best show to have. Think about it. You can go anywhere in space, and anywhere in time, and all they can do is come up with, you know, other people's ideas. That's not to say that you can't take somebody else's idea and write a completely different story about it. You know, we're all accustomed to the story of the mutiny on the Bounty. You know, it's the brave-hearted Fletcher Christian, who is the hero against the savage tyrant of a captain. When, of course, those who actually know the story know it's absolutely the other way. That Bligh was one of the three greatest navigators of the Southern Ocean. And his career was destroyed by the selfish, weak man Fletcher Christian, who within 18 months of landing his group of mutineers on Pitcairn, every single one of them were dead. You know, there's always a different way, different stories. Incidentally, by the way, Fletcher Christian had sailed with Bligh before. He knew exactly what it was about, and how it would go. He just was a weak man. Anyway, I think I'm a bit off the question there, isn't it? All I can say is that working with my fellow Sliders was one of the great joys of my life. We worked together so well. They were all marvels. And it broke my heart that we, you know, the show was sinking so fast that, you know, I did my level best to get fired. It's very hard to get fired in Hollywood. Because they think you know something they don't, you see. He wants to get fired. What does he know? Has he got a better show to go to? Has he got off with a bigger film? Something like that? We're not letting him go! But I love them all, and they were great guys. And it would be lovely to have just gone back and done 6 or 7 real good original stories. Well, that's an opportunity that's lost. Anyway, listen, time is up, it says. The time is up. I want to thank you all.
Everybody, John Rhys-Davies.